Are you able to see the captions which have been displayed here on my screen?
Yes, sir, they are visible.
Ah, right. Yeah, Priyanka. I hope you have joined the session.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, Amma. So, do you have any idea about some of your classmates, like Pavana Divya Basani?
Sir, she has left the course. Actually, she has filled a withdrawal application.
Okay. And what about Susmita Bahuvaruku?
Sorry, sir. What's the name?
Can you see my screen? Is my screen visible to you?
Yes, sir.
Susmita
Yes, sir. She didn't join the course. Only she took admission, and after that, I don't know who is
Bhogavarapu.
she.
And what about Seshadral Kishore Dhara, 20 MC MT 42?
He also left the course.
What about Kushal Kishore?
Kaushal Kishore also left this. Yes,
Oh, sorry, Kaushal Kishore. He has left the institution.
sir.
Oh,
Yes,
okay.
sir.
And
Mathili too, sir.
Maithili also. Oh, okay.
Yes, sir.
What about Mohid Ilrashid?
Sir, he's on our class, but why you are asking? Is he not attending classes, sir?
See, for the last 17 days,
Left
he
the
has
course,
not
sir.
opened the course page.
Okay.
Can you see here? Yeah.
Sir, he is from Sudan, so might be there are some issues with him.
Okay. Okay, the rest again 3 4 days the people are able to view the course pages and do the activities, but he is only for the last almost more than 2 weeks. That's what people not open the course page. Okay, anyway,
Yes.
I got the response. So almost 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 students have left now from this. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So. Any other queries from any of your classmates, or at present any doubts from regarding the previous class discussions? Are you able to do the exercises, please? Hello, am I audible to you?
Yes,
Yes,
sir,
sir.
we are doing
Yes,
it.
sir. Are you able to do the exercises what I have asked you to do?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So, was the information given in my slides is sufficient for you to do those exercises?
Yes,
Yes,
sir.
sir.
Yes, sir. Key points are there, and we also search for other related queries on the internet, so there's not much problem.
Oh, okay. So anyway, so if you are having any problems, please let me know as quickly as possible, okay? Or if you want me to repeat any topic also, there's no not an issue. We are on the track only as of now, the syllabus is concerned. Only thing is, I will extend the dates for you for your assignment submissions. Only those dates which are given as per the schedule are to make sure that you are going to submit the activities and you are on that process of learning and make sure that you are doing those tasks. That is giving you that is a deadline reasons for giving you those deadlines for those assignments. So they are not hard deadlines, but do not worry about those deadlines. So anyway, some of the students are having some problems at their hometowns regarding the internet connection and electricity connection also. Some of couple of them have put some emails to me. Anyway, I have extended those days. So other students, please don't be misinterpreted that the extension of date is meant for you to delay the process. It's not like that. So please complete your task as per your own schedule. Those extensions are only for those students who are having some difficulties at their places where they could not do it on time. For them only the extension is given. But for others, please do submit according to the schedule. So do not wait for the last day to submit the assignments. Okay, coming to today's discussion, this week I am just going with the topic extended markup language. Extensible markup language or extended markup language, more or less the both the meanings are the same. So so far we have seen the hypertext markup language. So can I hear from few of you, what is the purpose of an hypertext markup language, or what is the use of this HTML? Can anybody say a few words on that? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Can anybody say what is the advantage or what is the purpose or what is anything related to HTML? In your own words, please. I don't want the exact textbook definition.
Hello, sir.
Yes, please. Yes, Vinod, please go ahead.
Actually, HTML is for how data is and content is displayed on the web page.
So, HTML is for displaying the data or the content on the web page. Okay,
yes.
That is one. Yeah, okay, there is no wrong in this answer, but I am expecting some more views from others. Can anybody else, please?
Sir, we use tags to mark up the plain text areas, different sections of a plain text, so that a browser can display them in the correct format.
Okay, I will put this your meaning or your words in a little bit order. See, you are making the normal text as an hypertext by inserting certain tags. So it is not by tags you are putting the text there. So you have to say that your ordinary text is been made as an hypertext by using certain HTML tags, so that that hypertext can be referenced, or it can be seen, or it can be viewed, or it can be used for some other purpose on your web page. Yeah. Any other views, please? Hello.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, please. Any other views of that HTML? Hello. Yeah, please go ahead. Just speak what is that that is flashing into your mind? Please speak out. What you can say, it need not be exact textbook definition, I told you, but you need to speak it out. Speak out, please. Hello, am I audible to you?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
HTML can be used to pack any content that can be transmitted over the internet.
You have mentioned HTTP or HTML?
HTML.
Yeah, it's okay. You started with HTTP with the word. Anyway.
Yes. Yeah, I was confused.
So HTML, which needs to, which can be transported. You said that which can be transported on the web. Huh?
Yes, they can be transported through the web and they can be displayed on a browser.
It is not the exam. I mean, the meaning that is related to the HTML. It is not HTML, of course, or not exactly by done by your HTML. HTML, the way you are going to represent the data onto your web page. like one of your friends said that it is going to put your contents on the web page for hypertext, of course. So there are other protocols and other scripts that are help you to transport the data, but not the HTML. Since we have not discussed the other protocols, I will not mention anything at this moment. Okay, so let us go with this now. The topic
HTML is used for positioning of data within the page.
Oh, very good. Yes, positioning or the structuring of the data or organizing the data. In other terms, you are going to display the data or the content in a more organized manner. So that's what your document object model, you are going to have a tree structure where your elements of your web page are properly organized in a proper way so that you can access them, you can process them, you can manipulate them, and you can try to make use of different functionalities based on the user interaction on the web page. So all these things, HTML tags, of course, HTML programming language, the scripting language is helpful for you. Basically, it is a markup language where your ordinary text is been marked up, means it has been highlighted to prepare a hypertext in simple terms. So now we are going to have another markup language, which we call it as extensible markup language. In short, we call it as an XML. Now, suppose there is something where your web page or your web application wants to send data or actually wants to communicate with another web page or another web application. And that data which needs to be transported or to be communicated needs to be a very human friendly and at the same time machine readable too. So this is one requirement where something like you have a web page or a web application. That web application wants to communicate data, the information from one application to another or to a one web page to another web page, where that communication is such a that particular information can be easily readable by ourselves, that is by our by the humans, and at the same time that information can also be understood by the machine so that the machine can do accordingly or your web application do the processing accordingly. So this is one extensible markup language where some information which you can helpful for you, the information in a particular way can helpful for you to transport, and it can be easily readable and it can be easily transported across the web applications of your internet. So this is not the only markup language which has been used in the current trends or in the latest technologies, but this is one of the technology which has been widely used in the last decade for various web applications where they want to communicate with each other more effectively and user friendly, and of course a robust and flexible programming markup language or programming language for your information exchange. So here, well, let me take one example before you go to the actual content of this extensible markup language. Let me just put forward one example for you. Very simple example. Let us say you are going to So here there are two systems, of course, they are connected through the internet, and they want to communicate from one place to another place. What they want to communicate is something like this. If you are having some information such as assume that you have some of your friends, something like you have different set of friends, and maybe one of your best friend is so you have certain friends list with you, and you want to communicate this information from this computer to this computer, or from one web page to another web page, or from one application, web application, to another web application. Right? So what is the convenient way or the convenient process where this set of information is to be sent from this particular system to another system? And that particular application which sends data or your information from one web page to another web page on another system should be very much user friendly, or it in the sense that needs to be having a very human readable, and at the same time you need to have a flexible way of communication between these two systems. So how do you proceed for this, and what is the best way to do this communication between this set of information exchange? So the people have come up with a markup language feature. Basically, the markup language feature is something like this, where you arrange the information or you organize this information in terms of your tags. So here you have a set of friends list where you have the open tag and as well as the closing tag for you, and which gives you the list of all your friends. And because you have a different types of friends, a best friend or a very casual friend, or some categories of friends too, if there are there, you can categorize them, or you can make the characteristics based on that characteristics, you can prepare the list accordingly. So here something like this, I just put some information for you, your friend. So here you have a friend, how many friends are there. Basically, you can have certain names of this friend. So here AAA is there. Similarly, you can have other sets of friends. I'm just giving you a narration here where you can just simply understand you are going to keep a different set of friends list, and that information can be easily transferred from one application to your another application. So your best friend is going to be again given with the name here, for specifying you have a certain property here. What you find here is these are the tags. Of course, you have customized your own tags. These are basically your user defined tags. So these tags are different from your HTML tags. Please remember carefully. So here, these are all tags names which you have seen It depends from a person to person, a web developer to web developer. You can prepare your own set of tags, and you can prepare their corresponding attributes. You can have their own characteristics, and you can specify the corresponding values too. So these are not a predefined tags. Like in HTML, you have a predefined tags, the heading tag, the paragraph tag, the anchor tag, the image tag, the video tag. So like this, you have different elements of your web page where those tags are been predefined. You cannot change those tags. But here, you have the flexibility to have your own user-friendly tags, and you are defining your data or your information is organized in a particular way such that this information can be easily sent from one web page of your web application to another web page on another application or to another system over the internet, so that the communication, the exchange of information is going to be very easily and human. This information is a human readable information. Any human being, English language known person, can easily understand what is the meaning of a friend list and what is a friend and what is a best friend and what are the values inside these tags. So it is a human readable. At the same time, machine also can understand this structure, the syntax or the structure which you define in terms of open tag and closing tag, belongs, that value belongs to that particular set of object entity like this. So here, in order to make this markup language, this language which follows certain notations where your information is being kept and structured in a particular way, says that it is both human readable and as well as machine readable, and it is a robust, and of course the meanings in the syntax will give you a complete meaning. At the same time, it will not lose its meaning in that particular syntactic notations. So you prepare this information to be exchanged, and the language or the scripting language of this markup language is basically now what we are going to understand in terms of this called as extensible markup language. So this, what are the basics of this extensible markup language? What are the rules you need to follow? And how do you validate your XML pages using the document type definitions and using the schema structures? And of course, how do you check the syntax of your XML scriptings using the various parsers? And of course, how do we use of these scripts for various purposes that you see in the demos? So here, extensible markup language, computers contain data in incompatible formats. That's what any electronic gadget, when they start communicating from one system to another system. So if you have your data in a different formats, in a different incompatible formats, that exchange of information between the two entities or between the two web applications will not be appropriate. So they need some means of to exchange the data, which is robust, which is extensible, and of course a standard format for the data exchange. So here, extensible markup language is mainly designed to store and transport the data. So here you are storing the data, that is your friends' names A, B, C, D, those you are storing the data in this particular tags. And of course, this particular file which contains this information is being sent across this web applications. That's why it is easy to design, store, transport it. It is a self-descriptive and both human and as well as machine readable. That's what I was repeatedly saying. And it mostly, the information is wrapped in the tags. So you can see in this example, so your friends' names are being entirely wrapped into this tags itself, user-defined tags, of course. And of course, the extensible markup language and the hypertext markup language, the design goals are different. So basically, your XML is designed to carry the data, while HTML is for displaying the data. Like some of you said that the content has to be displayed on the web page, and it is to be seen on the web page like this. So similarly, HTML tags are predefined, but XML tags are not. So these are basically user-defined. And it is extensible, mostly designed so that applications still work even when there will be some minor modifications to the data. And of course, this is extensible markup language is a recommendation given by World Wide Web Consortium, W3C Consortium, from 1998 onwards. And it is also still widely used in our current times. of course, there are some improvements, and there are other technologies other than XML. So we'll see. There is another thing called as JSON. So that is another. Of course, it is also meant for storing and transporting the data in Internet of Things applications. Not only in Internet of Things applications. So in our various Internet applications too, you can use that format for appropriately storing and as well as for transporting the data. So we will see now how do we make use of this. For a simple example, you can see an example which looks like this. So your starting tags will be initially, the syntax is that you need to specify the tag name. So your less than symbol or your left angular braces followed by your question mark and XML. So the version number of that XML we are specifying, it is by default, it is 1.0, that is the XML version. And of course, the encoding text of this is we are following. The text encoding format is on the UTF-8. So once you give this syntax rule, followed by your user-defined tags. So for every open tag, there will be a corresponding closing tag. And of course, you have the hierarchy of these things. So here, there is a book. And of course, the attribute is on the category. And also, you have the other titles, authors, years, prizes. And of course, the same thing you can mention here. In this, you can mention this name, something like this. This is a user-defined. What is the name? You have it. So corresponding for an open tag, there will be a corresponding closing tag. So this is another example which you see here carefully. Like this, you can your XML file, which can be used for you to store your information of your books. Each book has got a different attributes, the title, the author of the book, year of publication, price. If you look into these parameters or these attributes, those attributes are representing the tags themselves for that entity book. And of course, this is the syntax you need to follow for various books. And all this collection of books information is put under a bookstore as a root tag. We call it as a root tag or the main tag here. The root tag here is the bookstore. Under that root, you have different parent-child tags. So the parent tag is basically your book, and your title, author, year, and price all belongs to the child of that particular parent. The book, which category belongs to the web. Similarly, you have another parent tag, which is a category belonging to programming, and you can have a different children for this set of parent tags. And all this is a combination of those user-defined tags here. So here, this XML, like your HTML, it also follows a tree structure. XML documents are formed as elements trees, and starts with the root element and followed by the child elements, just now I was mentioning to you. So elements can have a sub-elements, like depending on the properties, you can have a nested, and you can have a nested relationships between those, like a parent-child and the sibling relationships can be maintained in this particular tree structure of that XML. And of course, XML documents should follow the XML syntax rules, anything to be uniform across the data passage between those web applications. The syntax rules are very simple. You have the XML prologue statement, that is a starting XML statement itself. You need to specify the version and the text encoding style that we follow it. This is basically UTF-8. So this will be the first line. And of course, this is not part of your XML document, but this needs to inform to your browser so that it can understand what type of text and what is the hypertext format that is being followed in the following lines of the code. Always you'll have a closing tag, and of course, if you have an empty tag, you can close it there itself. So like in the HTML, you have the same rules for your tags, denotations. So of course, the XML tags are case sensitive. Please remember, your capital letters and the small letters are different in terms of when you're using it on the scripts. These XML elements must be nested properly, so you need to close those tags. Otherwise, this nesting will create a problem for later purpose when your data retrieval purpose is there and the data need to be processed. So otherwise, if they are not properly nested, if they are not properly communicated, then you may end up with wrong data processing. The XML attribute values must always be quoted. Attribute, these are related to the attributes. Please remember, these are the attributes that you've seen in this example. So here, the example here, in this these are the categories, the attribute that corresponding values have been in the quotes. So title, the language is the attribute, and it's been mentioned as an English like this. It should be, the value should be always vested in the quotes, very simple. Of course, the XML document should be well formed, following the syntax rules properly. And the syntax rules are very simple. And you can hear the white spaces are being preserved in XML. So if you have some white spaces in between the text, other than white spaces, you encourage return line feeder and the tab, even they have been considered in the when the receiving side of the web page has got this set of characters. And like similarly in the HTML page, you can use the ampersand, the less than symbol, the greater than, a was, and the quotation marks. So you can use this particular set of tags in your scripts for you to denote those set of symbols. And of course, the same in the HTML, you have the comment lines you can specify here. But now see here in XML, because the user-defined tags are going to be there, and you can have a different set of data values in your XML scripts. So something like we start with the character data, you can call simply as a C data section, and it has to be as the syntactically it has to be written like this: a less than symbol followed by exclamation mark, C data, and of course the open angular brace, then followed by whatever the message you want to type and what is the information that you want to put it in a tagged form, and corresponding closing you need to specify it. So here, this is what this basically a markup data can be made, and the corresponding message. Similarly, the XML elements is where it includes your start tags and end tags or the closing tags. That everything in between that start tag and the closing tag is nothing but some elements. So, and these elements are nothing but basically it can be ordinary text and its attributes or characteristics, or it can be nested to another element containing a different set of elements in the nested form. So this some of the examples we see now. One more important thing, please do make a note here because of one of the syntax rules, XML naming rules. So always your XML tag must start with your letter or an underscore and cannot start with the letters XML letter. That XML itself is the keyword here, and can contain letters, digits, hyphen, underscores, and it cannot contain your spaces in the tags. So once you specify a space in the tag name itself, it becomes an element of different property here again. And XML elements are extensible. That's what you can have your own extend the more the attributes, the more characteristics, with more information you need to provide for that particular entity, you can extend it and you can have more information to be understood by your web application. So let us see, and another important thing, XML attributes. So as I mentioned, XML tag has got certain attributes, and usually this always attributes are good for specifying the metadata. So, and you can easily identify something like ID in a tag. So ID is always gives you a specific identifier or an element ID. So that is the most important thing. And avoid attributes to the extent possible. Better to avoid the attributes, because the attributes will have different contextual meaning when the web pages or web applications do exchange the information. But it's not that to completely avoid, but you can, depending on the application requirements, you can set the attribute values and you can manage them accordingly. So the important thing is on the XML validation too. So here, how do you validate? How do you check whether you have written the XML web page XML structure properly or not? So before you go and checking the XML validation, so how do we write the XML program? So let me just open, you can open your notepad. Notepad++, and you can take any IDE or your text editor and start typing. So here, something like, as I mentioned to you, you can take this one. Second, let me just take the same example what I have given, what I have taken here. So you just put it here in the Notepad++. So you can put properly organized here carefully. Name. Of course, if you want a location, or if you want to have a place, something like that, you can easily have those things. I'm just keeping the open tags and the closing tags for this. Just save this one, save as into your you can give the extension to the file as .xml itself. Make it a little bit understand here. So once you prepare your something like this, okay. Now the other information I like to just share with you is you can check it on the net itself whether your formats are done properly or not. So you can, there are various tools available, online tools available for us. So you can have XML formatter online. You can use any of those tools which you see here. So mostly I will be using these tools. One is on the XML formatter. Once again, let me just see, free online XML formatter is there, and JSON formatter.org, you can use this one, and Code Beautify, of course. These are the a couple of online tools which will always will be helpful for us and handy to check and as well as to verify and validate and whether those informations are properly present or not. So similarly, you can just check for whether the format is correct or not and the values are given correct or not. So take this value, whatever you have written here, go to copy paste your on this, right? You can just so here. You can just paste it here and format this XML whatever you have written. So it will, it has formatted, and see, once you see it has formatted, it has been added. So your initial statement. So this is the syntax rule for this, for the formatted XML statement. So you can take this formatted XML statement, you can copy it, select all, copy it, and you can prepare your own XML file. Check whether you have written these things properly or not. Cannot copy it. So now it is properly formatted. The format means, of course, you can check the open tags and closing tags whether they are done or not. So similarly, you can use. Hello, am I audible to you? Are you on the line?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yeah, so,
yes. Are you following these examples? Yeah, good. So, right. So let me just take another one. You can take this JSON formatter also, start practicing these things. So you can input your XMLs and you can see this corresponding formatted XML on the right side. So if you want to check whether your format is there, not there or not, you can just for understanding, just remove this closing tag. So it is always giving you unclosed XML attribute. So once again, if you see the load data, yeah, if you have a file, you can just check it here. This is giving you a caution which you need to be looked here. You can just close the tag. Make yourself corrected. So once it is done, you can make. And here, you can see there is an XML tree here. So this tool can be helpful for you to prepare and get the XML trees. So the XML tree is basically a hierarchical set of objects. So in this, the object there is one, and in that object is basically a friend list. It's at the root, and in this friend list you have two sets of children. That is one friend, and another one is your best friend. So the friends, there are three friends for you. So this is a name AAA, similarly name BBB, similarly name CCC. So like this, you can access the XML elements. These elements of friend whose name is this, and of course whose name is BBB and whose name is CC, like this, who is the best friend. So once then XML tree, you can access it. Once it, see, this XML tree is generated internally by your browser to access those elements, and you can use the values of those elements for your data processing. So those things, it will be helpful for you. You need to check this format. So you need to prepare based on your various applications. You can prepare different XML tags and different XML attributes like this. So to check for the validation, there is something, there are other two different types of topics here. One is called as the document type definition, DTD. And there's another something called as schema. Schema means the structure. So XML schema definition, XSD, we call it as XSD, and another is document type definitions. So using document type definition and XSDs, you can validate your XML. It means in a software company, what happens is your software, as a programmer, you may not be having this schema or your document type definition, but your project leader or your project senior person in the project, they may give you, based on the software engineering requirements, they may give you something on the document type definitions and the schema definitions. They only give those schema definitions, and they may ask you to prepare the corresponding XML files. So once you prepare those XML files, remember that will be in terms of thousands of lines of code or thousands of lines of XML. Your XML values are so many objects values are to be prepared by you based on that definitions, based on that structure, based on that what do you call the, basically that is what it contains, like the blueprint, what your web page will contain and all, and that needs to be transported from one web application to another web application. So that schema will help for you to prepare your own set of XML files with various values, various data values. So it is equivalent to something like you need to check the syntax and whether you provided the complete information or not. So to check and to validate that information, usually your software group leaders and your software managers and software other experts will give you those schemas and document types, and they may ask you to prepare the corresponding XML files with a huge collection of data. So at that time, this validation is going to be very much useful for you. And of course, to validation also, you have certain other tools for us, which are, of course, there are online available tools for us. We have some XML validators. So again, the XML validation, you can say you can use the free formatter, or you can use codebeautify.org. Any of those tools are equivalently acceptable. Or XML validator by the W3 schools itself is the most well-known acceptable. You can use Liquid Technologies also. So there are so many tools available on the net. So you need not worry about all these things if you don't have appropriate structure verification for you. So let us see something on this. What is the XML schema definition? And before that, we'll see what is a document type definition is. So here, a document type definition defines the structure of the XML document. So it defines what should be the structure like what you have seen in this example. So this example has got a structure here. Friends list is on the root. The friends are on the child level, the relationship between this. And there are different types of friends, best friend, worst friend, enemies like this. You can prepare it. So different categories you can prepare. There's some structure which is given here. And what type of values this elements can have. And what categories this child elements or parent elements should have. Or what is the data type, what can values, what is the structure, what is the hierarchical level you need to follow. That kind of syntax rules and the structure rules should be followed for us. So that's the information that you need to be make sure that validation is always done before that is going to be in the live demonstration. So DTED defines the structure of the XML document, it defines the legal elements and what are the corresponding attributes for those elements. Applications can verify the validity of that XML through document type definition or through XSDs, XML schema definitions. So people can agree on a standard that is for exchanging the data. So when two applications, they start exchanging the data, obviously the protocol they need to follow, the rules they need to follow. So that is what this DTD and XSD will be helpful for us to prepare such kind of protocols, the structure, the elements, their attributes, what values you should be containing and all. So that user-friendly and a machine-readable format will be useful for us to transport and store the data across those web applications. So here you have something like this. So you are defining this is what your DTD document type, the document type you are giving followed by the exclamation mark. Of course, the prologue is there, XML version 1 encoding, followed by the document type, which uses the root value, which is a bookstore. Inside that, you are going to define what are the elements and what are the attributes. So elements for this bookstore, the book is an element, a title, the author, the year, the price, and the attribute list. The attribute list for the category is for the book. Similarly, the language is an attribute for the title. So you are going to specify those in terms of your syntactical definitions. So something like this, your bookstore followed by book category is equal to web. So this is basically, this is an internal representation within the same scripting file. You provide the structure and you also provide the actual values and the actual XML file. If you want to provide the structure in some other file as an external file with the, it's not related to the internal values, you can do so with the help of this .dtd file, where you are defining the structure in another file and you are linking that file here. So the external DTD declaration can be done like this. So the DTD element, that's what I just told you now, how to access this. Of course, the attributes list, so you can specify the character data only to be of a particular set of values or a set of characters. Like this, you can see, let us see one more demo on this one for the DTDs. Let me just complete the schema also, then we'll go for the demo. So XML schema is basically an XML-based alternative to the document type definition. To define the structure of the XML documents. So you don't have to learn this new language. This is very simple, user-friendly language for you to learn. Schemas are always, they support the different data types. If you are very much concerned for your data exchange, some data types are need to be very much in your requirement. So this schema definition declaration is important than document type. So you can put some restrictions on the data, what type of values, and you can easily check the validity on exchange of information. So before we go to this schema definition, how the schema looks like, so let us go to this some of these tools, and let me just show you some. The generation of those DTDs and let me just take some other tool for you to just to have an understanding here. So here the XML, we are going to just let me here some examples are there. Well, I'm just looking for some tool which you can directly convert to the DTD or to your SSDs. So just one second, let me get the tool name. Okay, here. Let me input the same file which we have done here. So of course, once you crypt it, then it says that it is a valid XML. Validity is checked, it is in that particular format. So let's go with another example. Here also you don't have that option, just one second please. Let us see this XML data here. XML to XSD. Some problem here. One second, please. You can, there are other tools too. Yeah, let me find out, but we'll get back to this. What I'm trying to search is to have the option of DT to XSD. So there are some tools, but exactly I cannot remember at this moment. I'll find out and let me, I'll inform you. So here we move on to the next one. So here XML schema, if you see here carefully, each element is been prefixed with XS. So here in this schema, the schema is nothing but the structure which you are defining for your XML file to have for that that element name, that element name so and so should be of so and so type, and of course the element type, if the type is basically the floating data type value. Basically, that is the price of that, and you can have several other data types here. So those data types, when you are defining it on the XML schema, you define like this: XS as a string value, or XS as a decimal, and of course integer value, or it is a boolean value. So your XML schema is going to support different data types here. So here, that's what the data types you can specify it. In this example, it is not there. Let us see. And of course, you can specify it to a default value or to a particular fixed value to a particular element. So this XML schema definition attributes, when you give these attributes, So this attribute type, just know your same and what is the value here. And attributes are optional by default. If you say they're required, definitely there should be a value for that particular set of attribute or to that particular corresponding element, which is very similar to that. And of course, you can define a complex type of elements, which involves hierarchical relationships or some kind of parent-child relationships exist too in the element definitions. So if an element contains child elements or attributes, it becomes obviously a complex type. So here you can see there is an element, a name is basically a rectangle, and that particular it is a complex type. These elements of this rectangle, where it can have an attribute, means the x and y values of this rectangle are defined like this in terms of your x and y, which is basically integer set of values. Their data types are given as xs as int, and of course the y is also your XML xs as an int, and this attributes x is going to be integer type, and similarly the name y is going to also have an integer data type value, which is defined in this. So you define your rectangle in this structure format, and whenever you prepare an XML file, that needs to have a certain values which can follow this particular structure. If it has, if this structure is not been followed, then it implies that basically it is going to be not following the XML values here. Similarly, what are the other, you can also have certain acceptable values in terms of regular expression. If at all you want to specify what are the possible values in terms of regular expression too. So like for your passwords, you can specify the length, you can specify what type of characters that is going to be specified. So the optional, the regular expression itself can be given here under the pattern of with the values specified. So this is how the syntax is going to be existing for you to prepare your own XML file. This is, of course, this is an example which gives you the gender, and the gender can be a possible set of values, male, female, and others, which is basically your string values, male, female, and others. And of course, if there's another element called password, that can have a different, it can be also a string with a set of possible values. So the length along, this is the length indicating that 10 characters of the 10 set of string values should be specified for this password itself. Like this, you can prepare your own XML files. There is another thing, something called as namespaces. So this namespace, always it will be helpful for you to resolve if you have two or more tags which are having the same tags, and those informations are to be combined. In the sense that when there are two or more web pages, in other terms, the web documents, and if the information is getting combined in your web application, that's what, if there is some requirement of that. So one document has got a table tag, even the other document also has got a table tag. So if you see on the left hand side, the table tag has got its other elements, such as the table rows and the table headings, whereas the other web page or the web document has got a user defined table tag. And of course, this user defined, this is what your extensible markup language, using that the table element, which is of course the complex type, is defined with material width and the length and the corresponding values. So if you combine these two tables, means if the two documents are combined and they are going to be processed, there may be some requirements of this web documents information exchange that takes place between the web applications. So at that time, there is a conflict does occur. So because both are having the tables, so when the information is being combined, this table tag left side elements are going to be combined with the right side elements. So to distinguish between them, the table tags of those respective web documents, since name conflicts can be avoided using something with the prefix values. So you give a prefix value to this table left hand side, similarly another prefix value to this right hand side table values, and similarly for the corresponding elements of this root tags. So you by that you can try to distinguish between them and you can avoid those conflicts. So here if you see, this is there is an XML NS. NS stands for naming namespaces. So for this table tag, you are given prefixed with h, small h here. So the small h colon table, the table tag, the XML naming space is considered for this h to be considered as a prefix. And this is one web page where that web page contains this particular set of values. So here in the table's elements, table elements, the table row is also prefixed with H. Similarly, the headings of those tables are also prefixed with these H's. And these prefixes will eliminate for you the conflicts when they are, the information is getting combined between this page HTML4 and another page called furniture from the same website, the web server. If it's hosting two different files and the information is to be exchanged or the combine or collection of information takes place for that web applications. So here the prefix for this for the other table tag of the another web page furniture table is given with the prefix small f. So here small f is what small f colon table XML naming space is f for this particular web page. So f colon material, f colon width, f colon length, f colon table. Similarly, you define this particular table tags on this particular web pages. So that will avoid the conflicts when you have the common tag names. This basically it is to resolve your name spaces, the same names which are existing on the same web server, and to avoid those conflicts. You have an XML parser too. What is the meaning of a parser? Can anybody tell me what is a parser is? Hello, am I audible to you?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please tell me what is a parser? What is the function of a parser? Any idea? No idea. Nobody has an idea what do you mean by a parser. So far, you have not heard about this word, parser. Parsing. Yes, please, you don't want to tell. Why this guy is asking very simple questions also. Yes, please.
Sir, in compilers,
it will parse the text, sir.
It will parse the?
The text or the code.
Okay, it will parse. What is the meaning of parsing?
To break.
Parsing is meant for breaking.
Next, for checking the syntax.
Sorry?
For checking the syntax.
Yeah, something Swati, I think you are telling, yes, to check the syntax. So basically, parsing is nothing but to check whether you, what are the statements that you have prepared or you have written, whether they are in accordance to certain rules or not. Basically, like your grammar. Why English grammar is there for you, or what is the purpose of a grammar for a language? I hope you understood my question. What does a grammar for a language do, or what is the purpose of a grammar for a language? Are you clear with my question, or have you understood it or not? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yep. So, did you understand my question properly? No answer. That for also.
Yes. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So, my question is: see, if any language, a language is meant for communication purpose, right? So, that communication should be effective and it should be fruitful for us. That communication should have certain kind of rules that we need to follow so that the two persons can understand each other. Once they don't follow certain rules, then obviously that understanding will not be proper, and your communication cannot, it's not a, the purpose of that communication will be lost, and otherwise there is no point in making the things to work properly to have understanding. In other terms, people do communicate with each other by following certain rules, by following certain grammar, by following certain syntaxes, by following certain strategies. So here, this for any programming language, of course, whether you have written, if you have written a C program correctly or not, so usually that is been checked by your compiler. Your compilation process do check that particular process, where whether your statements or the instructions that you have given to your computer or to the machine is in a proper way or not, whether it is in accordance to that particular specified rules or not. So it is according to that particular grammar or not. So that compilation process, when it happens, usually your compiler do check that particular syntactical checkings. Of course, you know what is that syntactical checking process is done basically, that process is nothing but parsing. Similarly, here for the XML also, you need to have a parser so that whatever the structure you follow, whether you are in accordance to the structure when you are want to communicate with another web page or to another web document or to a web, another web process. So parser is a software library that reads the XML document and checks it for your well-formedness. So whether your statements are properly formed and they're well to be well formed or not, and they are to be properly considered in the information dissemination or not. So it is the person who is going to check in the background is your parser. So client applications use method calls defined in the parser API. So basically, your client applications, your browser itself, use this the browsing browser engine will try to check if you are following certain rules or not for your XML document. So to receive, to request, or to modify information in the XML document, and if you want to manage those elements of those XML document, you can need to have certain APIs, application programming interfaces for them. So there are different types of parsers, the syntactical checkings or your structure checkings or your well-formedness checkings are there. Those are basically your document object model. And of course, simple API for XMLs, we call it as SACS models. So like this, you have different parsers which will help for you to check whether the XMLs that you prepared, whether they are following certain rules or not. So HTML, you know what is an HTML DOM is? What is your DOM does? Document object model. What is the purpose of this document object model? This last week we were discussing about DOM. Hello.
It is a structure of.
Yes, Tawab. It is a structure for.
Audible. Sir.
Yes. We are able to hear you. Please go ahead. Tawab, please go ahead. Go ahead, means yes. Please continue your answer.
Yes, the
structure of the.
Okay, it's a start and a start in the DOM.
Yeah. Okay, it is a structure well understood in the DOM. Okay, that's what maybe some problem at your side. So document means your web page objects. Your web page itself is one of the object. So that object is containing a different set of elements. And those elements are properly structured or not is checked by your DOM. So here, the HTML DOM defines a standard way for accessing and manipulating the HTML documents. So what are the various ways of accessing the HTML elements from the web documents, please? Anyone? Can anyone please say the last week's discussion? What are the various ways of accessing the HTML elements?
We can access by IDs, names.
Yes. So we can access by IDs by using get element by ID. Get element by ID, and that is by ID. And what are the other ways?
Tag name.
Get element by tag. Get element by tag using the tag name. The name of the tag itself, we can make use of to access those elements from the web document. Okay, are there any other ways still? Get element by ID, get element by tag. Apart from these two, are there any other ways
class.
Of get element by
class.
Class. So these are the various ways that you can access your HTML elements. Similarly, the XML DOM also has a way for accessing the XML tags. In other terms, the XML elements itself, the XML document elements itself. So DOM models XMLs as a set of node objects. The entire document is a document node itself. That is what the node. Every XML element is an XML node. And the text and the XML elements are your text nodes. And every attribute is an attribute node. And comments are, of course, the comment nodes. The nodes can be accessed with the JavaScript or other programming languages too. So I hope you have used the JavaScript to access the elements and manipulate the elements in the last week's exercises. Have you done that exercises, please? The last week practice?
Yes, sir.
So may I know, can anybody respond? What are the, how did you use your JavaScript to access and manipulate the HTML elements for any kind of application which you have done? Hello? Very silent? Hello? Raghavendra, are you online?
Yes, sir.
So have you done the last week's JavaScript examples?
Honestly, sir, I haven't practiced on it, sir.
So still you have not started it?
No, sir.
May I know what is the reason?
Sir, actually, for past 3 days, I'm in Tirupati. I came today morning only. So before going to Tirupati, I finished the previous week's assignment. I went off.
You have missed the JavaScript. So, okay. Yes, so excuse, but at least by do complete as quickly as possible, because every week we are moving ahead with the new topics, then you should not keep these things pending.
Okay, sir.
Right. Sure, sir. Yeah. Anybody else, please? Akhila.
Yes, sir.
So, have you used JavaScript to access the elements and to process them?
Till now, I'm not starting that assignment, sir. I'm busy with other assignments, so I'll start tomorrow today, sir.
You have not used those. Anybody else, please? Who has used it? So nobody has used the JavaScript to access the elements and process the values.
Sir, I have used.
Sachin Shah, please tell me.
It's for the validations of your...
Very good. At least a simple validation, Baba. Yeah, I asked you to prepare some forms to your username, your login, as well as your student registration form. So at least for validation, you might have accessed that username or a password for the login page, or something like a name, address, or your phone number for the user registration page. So this is some of the examples where you accessed your elements and you checked it whether they are following certain rules or not.
Yeah, yes.
Similarly, working with DOM, please remember getting access to DOM parser from the JavaScript. So how do you access the elements of those? You can, in your JavaScript, you can write the statement parser is equal to new DOM parser, and you can access that element XML doc, the entire document of your XML file, and you can collect those node elements by either get elements by tag name, that is most suitable for you, or by ID also you can do it, and you can traverse the node tree to access the corresponding elements. So actually, this is what the exercise I have given for you this week. So you can refer to this, the material which I have taken, the liquid technologies, you can see those things. The assignment for this is, you can see the exercises related to this week. write a JavaScript that reads XML file and prints the details as a tabular data. So you need to prepare your own data file and you need to print it using your JavaScript code. Assume appropriate members and data for the design and development of the required application. So somebody can take any application. It's up to you, your imagination. So if at all two people are taking the same application means and the same data means, definitely it is a copying issue. So please, that's why I don't want to specify any application here. So you please choose and you decide which application you want to consider it and write a JavaScript code that reads those XML files. That is one question. And the second question is, Mohammed, please, can you please mute? Mohammed Nisar Khan, can you please? Oh, you have raised the hand. So what is the question? Tell me, please, Mohammed. Hello. Mohammed Nisar, yeah, please tell me, what is your doubt? Mohammed Nisar, are you online? Network issue, sir. Okay, if it's possible for you to type the question or on the chat, it will be good. If you have any doubt, please type it on the chat window. Okay, that is one question which I have just given you for the next week to be completed. And the other question is, develop an application using HTML, CSS, and JavaScript such that access to XML data from URL parameters. Means the URL parameters means if you see now on my web browser, these are your URLs, please, the URL value. So from this URL value, if at all, whatever the values I specify, that will display the data based on the search keywords in the text box. So if at all you already prepared a search engine or a search type of application in the assignment two only. So you prepare, you take the values from your text box and send it through your URL. And that needs to be sent to your Google page and collect the information and display. So this is one small application which you can do it with the help of your HTML, CSS, JavaScript, and XML here. So these two exercises, try to provide the solution and submit it. Of course, the time is given to you. Any queries for this, please? Yes, please. Hello, am I audible to you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Please, any queries on this assignment or on this XML topics, please let me know, or on the previous topics. So just for information, there are non-teaching, non-editing teachers have been included in this week only. So most likely I'll be taking the help of those PhD research scholars in evaluating your assignments. So your assignments, of course, I'll also be involved in your evaluations of those assignments. So from now onwards, all your assignments, most likely the research scholars will be evaluating it, and they'll also be attending the sessions, and they'll also listen to the inputs what I'm giving and what is expected from that assignments and all. So from at least your first two assignments, you will get back the results by next week, so you can see your marks on that Moodle portal by next week for the first two assignments at least. Any other queries, please? I will just pause the session for a while, for 10 to 15 minutes. Anyway, I will be online. If you have any queries, please raise me. Raise to me. I will get back to you quickly. I will just, yes, please.
Sir, like assignment 2 in question is given like to make a portfolio page. Sir, I have done it through frame set.
I am repeatedly telling you in the last 2 interaction meetings also, frames are only given for you to have an idea, but don't use the frames from now onwards. It's not a good habit at all. That is just one small feature which you need to know.
Sir, how to assess the link on the same page? If you like click on objective and anything experience, so displaying data on the same.
You have to use CSS. Have you practiced on CSS, Vinod?
I'm not able to find, sir.
Find means? Don't look for the solution. You have to prepare your own solution here.
Okay.
Don't search for the solution. You have to put your logic. Yes, please. Are you able to understand, Vinod?
Okay, sir.
Try it. I'll give the logic. Just try it for a still try. If not, you don't get it, then don't worry. It's not that I'll give the solution for you, but I'll give time for you to think and put your ideas. See, this web technology is basically your ideas has to be materialized. Your ideas has to be exhibited. The more the ideas, the more the work you give to your brain, that will fine-tune your ideas rather than just depending ideas on somebody else or mine or the Google's ideas or the responses you get it on the YouTube or in the Google. Those ideas are not the appropriate ideas for you. You need to prepare your own innovative ideas, especially for your web applications, please. The more innovation, the more better thinking is. The thinking effort should be increased to get the more innovative ideas, and that will help for you in the long run. Any other queries, please? Already Tawab has given one hint for you. You know, on the chat window, Tawab has given you, see, he has given an internal hyperlink, okay?
Yes, sir.
And in the CSS, he has defined, so there is a definition NAV-link in the CSS file. Any other doubts, please? Any other queries? Anyway, I'll pause the session here for a while, and I'll be online only. So I'll get back to you within another 15-20 minutes. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'll just mute my video and audio, but you can call me. You can raise your hands, and you can put forward your questions in the chat window, or you can directly talk to me. Okay? I'll be online here only.